Hey, honey.
Yes, Barry?
Let's get out of here.
Where are we going?
Where do we always go?
Hasta encontrar la playa, por eso grito al mundo, yo soy de Puerto Vallarta. Samba de Puerto Vallarta, noche de arrullo en el mar. Samba de Puerto Vallarta.
Hello, fellow travelers, and welcome to this episode of the Puerto Vallarta Travel Show. I'm your host, Barry Kessler, and I'm just so happy introducing you to my favorite vacation destination. Maybe it's even yours, and that's Puerto Vallarta, Mexico. The music you're listening to is performed by Alberto Perez, and Alberto is the owner of the Lapa Lapa group of restaurants. Those are the Lapa Lapa, Puerto Vallarta's oldest restaurant on the famous Los Muertos Beach, and the El Dorado Restaurant Beach Club right next door. So you can enjoy that fantastic view of the Los Muertos Pier, all lit up at night in beautiful colors, or during the day in its grand splendor for breakfast, lunch, or dinner, seated with your toes in the sand, right at the water's edge. It's so romantic. It's so Puerto Vallarta, my friends. This week, we are going to get a twofer, and considering that it's restaurant week, well, it just makes perfect sense. We're going to visit Ulf Henriksen, and Ulf has two restaurants. He, along with his partner Bernard, run Vitea Oceanfront Bistro and Trio Restaurant, and I'm just excited to be introducing you to Ulf. But before we get there, let's see what's happening this week in Puerto Vallarta, 21st of September, 2020. Well, finally, things have opened up on the Malecón in Puerto Vallarta. The yellow caution tape has come down all along the Malecón, and the people can once again walk freely and sit down on the benches and hang on the sculptures. And in fact, the food booths are returning as well. Those are the ones that are alongside that Naval Museum. So time to line up for your elotes and your handmade ice creams and your homemade pies and cakes, and come on. Now, I found a very interesting article here in Vallarta Opina Online. It's translated from the Spanish. It's dated September 2nd, 2020, and it says the wait is over, that in October, the green traffic light and back-to-school reopenings will be happening in Puerto Vallarta. Reads, a few days after the announcement of the new epidemiological traffic light in the country, in which practically all the states abandoned the red traffic light, except for Colima, 10 states are already on a yellow traffic light. The new projection is that almost the entire country ends the pandemic by the end of next October. The Undersecretary of Prevention and Health Promotion, Hugo Lopez-Gatell, said so at the same conference in which he said that Mexico had already received the first doses of the influenza vaccine at the rate that we're going. And according to the new projections, all states will be on a green light by November so that educational activities can resume relatively normally. It turns out that the projection is that half of the states in the country will be on the green light for the first half of October, while the other half will reach that same level for the second half. There are very few states that will have to wait until November to be optimal conditions to enter what is the lowest risk state in the COVID-19 pandemic. We have outlined, based on mathematical projections, that in October, roughly the first half of the states in the first fortnight, the second half in the second fortnight, and there are some, two or three states, that will possibly go until November to reach that green traffic light to the extent that the traffic lights begin to be green. The educational space can be opened, said Lopez-Gatell. Three states that could be left behind were not disclosed. At the moment, the only state that remains on red traffic light is Colima. At the green traffic light, all activities will be allowed, including school activities, which could already be face-to-face by those dates. When the green traffic light comes into force, according to protocol of the Ministry of Health, practically all economic activities could be carried out normally again without abandoning health prevention measures until a vaccine against COVID-19 is developed, and this is applied to the general population. In this way, clubs, bars, restaurants, shopping malls, any place in service can now function again without restrictions for the dates on which the green traffic light comes into effect. Likewise, the return to all classes at all educational levels could be face-to-face, since the level of infections would no longer be alarming. Therefore, elementary schools, secondary schools, high schools, and university and graduate schools could once again exercise their conventional activities. And I have a link to that article in the show notes. So this is very interesting. Looks like Mexico is looking to stick to their current health protocols until they have a vaccine. And they say that they're waiting for that to be applied to the general public. So I guess the question will be, how do you guys feel about taking the vaccine? Will you be taking a vaccine? Just a question. Now, here's some more old normal news. It's also from Vallarta Opina Online. It says that cruise ships will return to Puerto Vallarta by mid-November 2020. And it reads the international cruise sector is preparing to return to the sea next November on the Mexican Riviera route made up of Puerto Vallarta, Mazatlan, and Cabo San Lucas. Arturo Musiganem, president of the Mexican Cruise Association and representative of shipping lines in Mexico, pointed out that although the coronavirus pandemic seriously affected the international cruise industry since last March, it was time to prepare for reactivation of the sector in Mexico. He reported that the shipping companies Norwegian Cruise Line and Carnival Cruise Lines have already confirmed that their return to the Mexican Riviera route will begin with both ships from the second half of next November. The first shipping line that announced its return to the Mexican Riviera is Norwegian Cruise Line, with a ship that will arrive in Vallarta, Mazatlan, and Cabo. And Carnival also warned that its Panorama Cruise, which opened shortly before the pandemic and is one of the best ships, would be returning in mid to late November. Musiganem also explained that the forecasts of the rest of the shipping lines that carry out tours of the Mexican Riviera route are to return to sail on a regular basis, as they did before the coronavirus pandemic, in the months of January and February of next year. Back in January or February, we will begin to feel a little more constant, the arrivals of cruise ships, although with their reservations, because as long as there is no coronavirus vaccine, there is a risk, and many people are afraid of getting on a ship. He said that, however, the international cruise ships will continue to have all the health security protocols against COVID-19, including healthy distance. That's why the ship will even have to operate in the first months of reactivation with a lower passenger capacity in order to navigate with a low occupancy that reduces the risk of contagion from the coronavirus. In the case of the first cruise ships that will return to the Mexican Riviera route in November, it's expected that passenger occupancy will not exceed 60 or 70%, which will mean receiving around 2,000 or 2,500 tourists at most in each arrival of a boat at these beach destinations. And I have a link to that article, sorry it was a little rough, in the show notes. So, I guess the question is, would any of you be ready to get on a cruise ship right now? Or do you think it's too soon to get on a cruise ship? I imagine that prices are going to be great. But what do you think? Are they going to have masks? They're going to have spacing, right? No buffets? No more midnight snacks? I don't know. We'll see. Anyway, let me know if you think that you would like to get on a ship and come down to Puerto Vallarta. Now, the mariachis are returning to the Sheraton Sunday Brunch. I told you that the Sunday Brunch was back, and the Mariachis Nuevo Cantonal PV tweeted out that they are going to be performing Sundays during the brunch. So, yep, it's all coming on back there. Wonderful news. Now, there are plans to expand the Malecon by a kilometer in length. They're going to lengthen it from where the Rosita Hotel is all the way to the Sheraton. Let me read here from Vallarta Opina Online again. It says they plan to expand the Malecon by 1 kilometer from Rosita Hotel to the Sheraton. During his fifth government report, the mayor of Puerto Vallarta, Arturo Davalos Peña, announced the intention of managing the expansion of the current main Malecon so that it reactivates the economy of the Cinco de Diciembre neighborhood and connects with the hotel zone. Another pending, the continuation of the Puerto Vallarta Malecon from Hotel Rosita to Sheraton Hotel, where we are going to reactivate the entire Cinco de Diciembre neighborhood and Paraguay Street, which will become a very important economically active area, he said. Measured from the satellite view of Google Earth, this section measures about 1 kilometer from where the concrete slab with the wave breakers ends at the Hotel Rosita until the empty land next to the Sheraton Bougainvilleas Hotel ends there, passing over the entire strip from the beach. The mayor also promised the management to place hydraulic concrete on Federal Highway 200 from Palmares to Boca de Tomatlan because it costs us a lot to maintain that section, which is currently made of asphalt. In the same report, he promised the construction of a new section for the Boca de Tomatlan boardwalk and a new one in Mismo Loya, where the movie La Noche de la Iguana, Night of the Iguana, was filmed in 1964. And that also was pretty rough. Sorry about that translation, but I have a link to it in the show notes. And you can find it, of course, at www.puertovallartravelshow.com. So what do you guys think about those plans? How long do you think it's going to take them to build that kilometer worth of Malecon? When do you think they're going to start that? Anyway, we'll find out. Let's watch. Let's see what happens and see where this all leads. Now, I'm going to talk with a couple of developers, actually, next time I'm in Puerto Vallarta. A couple of them that are building and doing improvements over at the Cinco de Diciembre neighborhood. And that'll be, of course, in November. Now, I got a couple of emails that I wanted to cover, but you know what? Let's put those off for next week, and let's just go right to the interview, shall we? Now, our guest this week is Ulf Hendrickson, and Ulf is one of the partners of two of the greatest restaurants in Puerto Vallarta. There's so many great restaurants in Puerto Vallarta, and, you know, of course, it's Restaurant Week right now, and these two are fantastic. One of them is Trio Restaurant. It's on Guerrero in Centro Vallarta. It's a half a block from Mr. Barracuda. You know what Mr. Barracuda is? It's right near the church, right near the Iglesia de Nuestra Señora de Guadalupe. And then the other is a restaurant on the Malecon. It's called Vitea Ocean Front Bistro. And it's on the Malecóncito. It's not on the original Malecon. But I'm going to let Ulf tell you about both of the restaurants. But after my last visit last month, I'm going to have to add Vitea to my list of favorite breakfast spots because I mean, I had one of the greatest breakfasts I've ever had in Puerto Vallarta right there. I've had lunch and I've had dinner there, but I've never had a breakfast there. So it's going to be really hard to fit another great favorite breakfast place in, but Vitea is now going to be on my list. Now, Vitea is set up in a way so that there's an inside, which can be air-conditioned and closed off, and then there is a sidewalk patio. Sidewalk seating right there in front of Vitea. It's pretty modern. It's clean. The location is fantastic. And it makes just an excellent people-watching location because it's got this great view of the ocean. and, you know, the strolling actors and all the characters that walk along the Malecon. Now, Trio is a little bit different. It's much more staid, it's more fancy, it's more formal, and it's special. It's really special from the moment that you walk in. The interior is really pretty. It's stately, it's beautiful, attention to detail, all that great stuff. And then there's also an upper dining area that you have to come inside it to actually see it. To get the full impact of this space. If you've seen it from the front end of the dining area, then you haven't seen the entire restaurant without actually getting inside of it. Now, as you listen to Ulf, I want you to pay attention to the places that he has been due to all of his talents in the kitchen, okay? Now, these talents, they took Ulf all over the world. Think about it. Think about what a talented chef can do and where they can go. And it's amazing when you listen to his story. Now, also, as you listen to his story, I want you to see if you can see a pattern with chefs that come to Puerto Vallarta and fall in love with the town and fall in love with with a lady. It's always a woman's fault, right? Anyway, before I say too much, let's go right now. Let's get to the dining room over at Vitea. Get a killer view of the Bahía de Banderas, and let's meet my new friend, and now yours, Chef Ulf Henriksen, of Trio Restaurant and Vitea Oceanfront Bistro, Puerto Vallarta, Mexico. Ulf, thanks for coming on the show today.
Thank you. Pleasure to be with you.
Tell us a little bit about yourself. Where are you from? And what was your path that led you to Puerto Vallarta?
I'm from a place called Kalix in northern Sweden, very close to the border to Finland. That's where I was born 52 years ago. And how I ended up in Vallarta, as when I was 19, I went traveling to Southeast Asia and Australia. I worked for a while in Australia. I came back to Sweden. I thought Sweden was boring then, so I just stayed there for 4 months, and after that, I went to work in Switzerland and in Austria, and then once again in Switzerland. And then I came here to Mexico for a vacation, but in that time, it's like a backpacker. You know, we used to have that the Lonely Planet guys, you know?
Oh, remember? Yeah, sure.
You remember that?
Yeah, I think they still have a half-dead website out there somewhere.
Yeah. I used to have that one in Southeast Asia on a shoestring when I was in Asia. And so I did the same thing here in Mexico. So I came here to Mexico, and I came here first to Puerto Vallarta. I stayed here for a few days, and I told, when I came at the airport, that please put me I want to stay in the cheapest hotel to the taxi driver. So I stayed in a very, very simple hotel. And after a few days here, I kind of liked it, but it's not the beaches in somewhere. They were very nice, but not as nice like in Phuket or in Thailand. And so yeah. I thought, like, I want to go somewhere else to see. So I read about it in my guidebook about Ixtapa, Zihuatanejo. So I went to Zihuatanejo. Ixtapa was okay, but I really liked Zihuatanejo. And when I was there, I met this girl, which is now my wife. We've been married now for 27 years.
That's dangerous, man. That's dangerous. You're backpacking and you meet a girl, huh?
Yeah. So that's why.
Congratulations. You've been married how long?
27 years.
Oh, they said it wouldn't last. Man, that's great. Yes. Good for you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. So I went to see her then. She was from Guadalajara, so I went to see her, and I met some people there. And then we're working in a hotel, in the Hyatt Hotel. And I was so I went back then to Switzerland, and I already had a contract for the summer season in Switzerland. But when I was there, I used to send her letters and so on, and I sent some applications. And by the end of August, I got a phone call that they want to interview me in Montreux in Switzerland, the Hyatt Corporation. So I went for the interview there, and they hired me. So I came here when I was 24 years old to Puerto Vallarta, and I thought, like, Puerto Vallarta is not so far away from Guadalajara, so it's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So good choice.
Yes. So I ended up being at the Hyatt in Puerto Vallarta when I was 24. I didn't speak one word Spanish, nothing. So it was my beginning, and this was before the internet and everything. So it was no way to learn or find out anything, how how everything works, no? So it's actually, for me, the first year when I was in Mexico, it was a complete culture shock.
I bet.
It was because I was used to everything was either white or black. And here, and I learned that with a totally different culture, because Switzerland was working was very similar to Sweden, the way things were running, but it was totally different. And I used to spend every night calling then my girlfriend to Guadalajara, and she explained what happened during the day, and she explained to me why people reacted the way they reacted with me. And for example, when I was learning Spanish, they told the Spanish teacher to tell me to say por favor, because I was used with the military style. In Europe, working in the kitchen is like military style orders. You don't tell them, could you please be so kind and clean? You just tell them to clean. And it's not being mean or be offensive anyway. So that's what they taught me. So I learned in the beginning.
So you weren't being asked please to do stuff, right? You were just being told to do stuff.
No, I was in charge of a
group. Oh, you were in charge?
Yeah, I was the chef of the hotels. And when I had my women twice my age, and I told them to clean. And I didn't tell them, you know, Senora, could you please be so kind and clean?
Oh, I see.
They would get very upset with me. And I learned all that fast, no?
No kidding. That's something you got to learn fast.
Yes. So I learned that fast also. And also that when I asked somebody that, when are they coming, my order of raspberries, for example, they said, yeah, tomorrow, 10 o'clock. I believe them. Always believe them, because that's the way I was brought up. Everything, what people said, always believed. And it wasn't that way. And many times it was not because they were lying, but so many things can happen until next day with the supplier, or the climate, or whatever. So you learn to improvise. So that's something I learned a lot also during the first year here. But I really liked it, and so I stayed here, and then I went to another hotel working, and everything was fine, and we got married. And then suddenly they changed president here in Mexico. And suddenly I was making half of my money. I had to pay my rent, living in the marina and everything. And I stayed for 8 months. And then I told, you know what, I'm leaving. I thought it was easy to get a job somewhere else in Mexico, but it was almost impossible. So I ended up moving back to Europe. And through a headhunter, he called me when I arrived in Europe, they had a job for me in Helsinki, in Finland. So I ended up in Finland working there for a few years for a hotel chain. Then in Central America, and I was always visiting here, Puerto Vallarta, because I liked it still very much, and plus my wife's family, and Bernard, who is my partner at Trio and Vitea. He was at that time, he was the chef of Maximilian.
Oh.
Kaiser Maximilian,
yeah.
And he opened up a place. I remember he told me he's going to open up a place to get with another German chef. And after a while, that other German chef, he wanted to leave. So he offered me his other chef's shares. So in the end, I ended up coming back here in 2001. So I'm back here in Puerto Rico since 2001 as a partner, first in Trio. Then we opened Vitea together in 2004.
Fantastic.
Yes.
Wow. And both restaurants are, you know, beautiful restaurants. They are, I would say like Trio is more of like a upper crust kind of a place.
Yes, it's only open for dinner, and it's more traditional. It's a lot of European influence, but using a lot of local ingredients, and also because we're staying here so many years, a lot of techniques and things what they do in Mexico, and because of the weather, the climate, the use of a lot of fresh herbs and garlic and tomatoes and also chilies, and we're also living next to the ocean, we're using a lot of fresh fish, the best local produce what we can get. But then one day we were walking here and we saw this place was for sale, was now Vitea. And this was before the Malecón was renovated.
Oh, before the extension, huh?
Yeah, you remember it used to be a parking lot.
Yeah.
To the Bancomer Bank. It used to be next here. And it was not very nice area, but we saw the potential. And it, because it was so close, to the other restaurant. We thought like it's been a good place to open up something for like breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and we can use some of the infrastructure we have at the other restaurant. For example, we have so we did that 2004. We opened up here, but you remember 2001 year before we had the hurricane here.
Yeah, that was Kenna.
Yes. And so we, but the good thing we were not open.
You weren't open then,
no,
right?
No, we didn't put anything. But the year after we opened up here, and in the beginning, it was. And then they started to remodel outside here. There used to be a big fence. Yeah, nobody was allowed to walk outside. But we opened anyway. And then little by little, we managed. In the beginning, we were not allowed to have any tables outside. We only opened up for lunch and dinner. Then they were open 1.5 year later. We opened up for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Now we open 7 days a week, and now in November it will be 16 years. And in Trio, next week, will be, well, it's 23 years open.
Wow.
So it's quite a long time. Yeah.
It is a long time, especially for Puerto Vallarta.
Yes.
I mean, restaurants come and go.
Yes.
You skipped over the part where you're a trained chef. Where did you learn your craft?
I went to like a chef school first in Sweden. When I was 14 or 15, first I made some practice in school in Sweden. You can choose to go like a practice for a few weeks, something you're interested in, maybe later to study. So I went to a restaurant, I stayed there, and they offered me, I liked it so much, so I got a job there for every week. And after that, then I used to work in the summertime. Then I studied like a chef school.
Uh-huh.
When I finished that, I worked a little bit in southern Sweden. I worked in Stockholm. I worked on a boat, and I saved money. And then I met a guy from a Swedish guy. We worked together on the boat. Then he went to Australia, and he came back, and he told all these nice things about Australia. So I saved some money. So I went first to Southeast Asia and then to Australia. I ended up working with him for a few months in Australia. And then he was taking a pilot license, so we rented an airplane and we were flying around Australia for a while and having fun, and then I went back to Southeast Asia and back to Sweden, and I thought Sweden was boring, so that's why I saw a job in Zurich in Switzerland, so I went working in Zurich.
Okay, so that's that explains why it is that everybody wants you. It's because you've had all of that training, you've had all that experience since you were 14 years old.
Yeah,
wow.
And also when I was in Switzerland, I did some in different private schools. I went to a special school where they do like sugar work. So I know how to make pulled sugar figures, and I will be also been competing in that kind of things and in Switzerland and also other private schools. And then I went to a friend of mine. We worked together in Switzerland. He had the Austrian girlfriend. So he went with her to Vienna, and then working in a gourmet restaurant, and I went to see him, and he asked me, you don't want to work here? So I ended up in Vienna, working in a gourmet restaurant in Vienna.
Wow.
In Austria, and because I studied in school, German, so for me it was no problem with the language either, so.
No, none at all. You still got that German accent on you, too. Got to tell
yeah,
you.
Man.
I mean, I hear the Swedish in there, but
yes.
I hear the German.
Yeah, I speak every day with Bernard, my business partner. We speak German to each other.
Yeah.
Back home, I speak Spanish and Swedish. I speak with my father, my sisters in Sweden. And so it's,
yeah.
Yeah.
All right, tell us a little bit about the menu here at Vitea.
Yeah, hey, Vitea, we have like for the breakfast, our market more is. It's more focused on Mexican breakfast, which I think is one of the best breakfast dishes in the world, I would say.
Yeah.
You know, they have so many options, so many things, wonderful things what they're doing with breakfast. So, and also because of the market, it's many local people we'll be having here for breakfast because we can't compete with the all-inclusive hotels. So our market for breakfast is a lot of local people. And we make our own bread here every day. All the sweet rolls, all the baguette, everything is made daily. And we have some healthy options and a lot of fruits, a lot of vegetables. And, of course, here in the morning in front of the ocean. And we are so lucky because this side of where Vitea is oceanfront. The building is we always have shade here in the morning.
Yeah.
So you can sit here outside and there's never been a sun in your face and everything like that. So
it's
wonderful.
Yeah, it sure is. And the view is beautiful, and you have a statue right in front there, which is beautiful.
Yes.
All right, so what's your lunch menu like?
The lunch menu, what we have here is we try to do a little bit of like local fish. Like we prepare simple ways like a zarandeado style fish or grilled fish. We have some sandwiches. We have some European items also like a quiche that many people, they love. We have a spinach quiche. We have a roasted vegetable quiche. And we also have some desserts. And also lunch here, most of the lunch is more like a little bit lighter side. And also we have normally during the high season, we have a lot of people coming from the cruise ships. They're walking around town and they want to sit down and have a nice snack or something. And it's a quite big market for us during the high season. And people coming into town for having lunch from La Cruz or from Punta Mita or something. It's just, I think we are one of the few like serious places downtown serving lunch.
That's right, and consistently good, I got to tell you.
Yeah, and we make everything ourselves. Everything, we serve a hamburger. We grind the meat ourselves. We make the bun ourselves. We have fresh pasta. Everything is made in house. Also, we do our own ice cream. Everything is made in house. No.
Yeah. Wow. Cool. How about dinner? Is dinner kind of a step up from that lunch, isn't it?
For dinner, then it's more step up. Then we try to be more more fancy. A lot of using seasonal ingredients, and it's more formal in the high season. We also have many evenings. We have live music here, and we have more dishes. It's more complicated dishes. So it's a lot of fresh fish, seafood, and also some. You're running a lot of chef specials. And so it's a lot of European techniques we're using. We're still for example, making sauces. You know, the tradition to make a real sauce nowadays seems to be
disappeared. Yes. Right? Tell that I can or whatever.
Yes.
You know.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. And you got a full bar.
Yes, we have a full bar. And it's open also breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And same there, we have like signature drinks. And every day we make our own juices and a lot of special cocktails, what we have here. And we have some local beers also. And we have some mezcal or some raicilla. And of course, we are in the state of Jalisco, so we have some special tequilas that people love to try.
Very good. Very good, of course. All right, so now let's move on. Let's go back. Let's go over up the street. Let's go to Trio. Let's talk about Trio. They're just open for dinner, right? They're not breakfast or lunch.
Yeah, for dinner. We're open for dinner 7 days a week. So you can come any day a week if you want to. And now we open as of 5 o'clock in the afternoon until 11 o'clock at night. And there it's everything. When you come in to the restaurant, there's a lot of all the furniture, all the the bar, everything, the details. It's a local woods made of a master carpenter. He's now over 80 years old. He's been doing furnitures for us now for the last over since we opened. It's a wonderful.
Wow.
His name is Don Choi. We call him Don Choi, and all the furniture are made of parota, which is it's a hard wood.
And lasts forever.
Yes. So it's like it's a wonderful touch. We don't want to be that kind of. We have furniture that goes. It's now in fashion. I mean, 5 years out of fashion. It's just real furnitures and the real stuff. And also with the food, it's also a lot of fresh fish, meat, fresh pasta, a lot of European techniques using Mexican ingredients. And there we have a lot of we have a very large wine cellar. And Bernard, my business partner, he's a true wine lover. So it's very also focused on wine and also the matching with wine.
Ah, yeah.
And also our maître d's and the waiters, they really know how to recommend wine. And many of the wines that we are offering, you can't find them everywhere. It's a sale. And try to really have nice wine in different segments, from very economical one until to expensive ones. So it's
to make it, yeah, so make it everybody can yes. enjoy.
Yes.
Is there a favorite dish over there at Trio?
Yeah, I would say that one of the most famous dishes and people really love is the red snapper with the lime cilantro sauce.
Okay.
Yeah, it's, I don't know if you have tried that one. It's a wonderful dish. It's been on the menu since we opened. And also, of course, we have normally, when it's getting a little bit cooler, we have this also. We have a sea bass, and it comes with a sauerkraut, which sounds very strange. And it comes with a white peppercorn sauce and with sautéed grapes and mushrooms. It's a wonderful, and served on mashed potato. And we have people coming just for that dish,
yeah.
year after year.
Okay, you
they
hear that?
It.
You hear that, everybody? So if you sit down and you're just scratching your head over at Trio wondering what to get, Olaf just told you what to get. Okay.
Yes.
How about here? What's the favorite dish over here at Vikea?
Here, I would say probably we have the favorite dish here. We have a roasted cauliflower for as a starter, and it's topped with goat cheese and capers and lime zest, and it comes with a sauce made with roasted poblano peppers and spinach, and people love that one too.
Wow. Okay, and that's vegetarian. That's for all you people out
yes.
there that don't eat the meat. So.
Yes. And of course, we have people love also. Is that we have this zarandeado style fish. It's like a fish fillet, and it's oven roasted with some like a chili paste, and it's really wonderful. Those people love that one too.
Good. Well, I haven't had anything here that I didn't like. So what can I tell you?
Yeah.
Let's leave Vitia and let's leave Trio for just a minute. Let's go out into Puerto Vallarta.
Uh-huh.
If you were going to go out of town for a day and come back, same day,
uh-huh.
where would you go?
Where I would go, maybe I would go to the Botanical Garden. I love that place. So I think it's wonderful. Or I would go maybe to Sayulita or to Punta Mita over the day also. I think it's just very wonderful places to go discover.
What do you do when you go to Punta Mita?
To Punta Mita?
I mean, you're heading out to Punta Mita. What's on your mind? What are you going to do?
We used to go there a lot before is where you have like Anclote. You have small restaurants down there. And lately also we've been to where you have the Iberostar Hotel close to there. It's a place from Barracuda. El Barracuda opened uh-huh. up. It's very nice. So you're being close to the ocean. No? And on the sometimes on the way back, we stop and in La Cruz and we go having a like early dinner on tacos on the street. You heard about that place?
Yeah.
In La Cruz.
In Veracruz.
Yeah. Yes. My daughters, they love that place.
Tacos in the street.
Yeah, tacos on the street. And they are actually served on the street. You know?
Yeah, I imagine that's,
yes.
you know. Okay, so if you were going to go away for 3 days,
yes.
where would you go?
Probably for 3 days, I would go to Guadalajara because it's a hometown of my wife and my daughter. She's studying there, and I really like the atmosphere for a few days. Maybe not living there because it's so big nowadays. But go there's a lot of energy. It's always very fun to go to discover new restaurants or go to the. You can also go to Tlaquepaque or Tonalá. You know, see the Mexican handicrafts, all the art what they're making is wonderful. Or you can also go day overdrive to Chapala Lake and walk around there. It's a beautiful climate. People are very friendly. I like that a lot too.
Very good. All right. Those are all great suggestions. If you had a word of advice for a first-time traveler, a first-time visitor to Puerto Vallarta, what would it be?
Probably study a little bit before what you want to do, and probably don't if it's taxi drivers or people that have a hotel and so recommending things, is that sometimes you should not forget that these people, they get commission to recommend stuff. For example, we don't pay any commission, so if people come here, this is because word of mouth and people like it. So that I should be careful sometimes that it's not always the best places or the best shopping, whatever, because they get paid for to recommend. So see, if you have some friends who've been in town, or you can check online different things, or like asking normal local people what they recommend. I think it's the best idea, because if you ask some guy in the hotel or at the airport,
you never know where you're going to end up.
No,
that's right. So stick to your list, you guys. Make a list, and you know,
yes,
don't let people dissuade you. Go try the food that's good.
Yes,
great suggestions, because a lot of us are on here for maybe a week, and
yes,
you know, if you've missed a dinner, you've missed something.
Yes,
you know. Do you have a word of warning for maybe a first time traveler here? Don't listen to the taxi drivers.
No, but I would say that most people are here. They're very friendly, very nice people. So I wouldn't say, but maybe the word of warning would be that don't do things what you wouldn't do back home, you know?
Yeah.
If you go with a total stranger at 3 o'clock in the morning somewhere with him, would you do that back home? No? So why do you do it here then? You know? So this kind of things. Just use common sense. But I know it's nothing is happening. I've been living here now so many years, and I'm just a regular person. And nobody has robbed me. Nobody has done anything to me or my family, and I'm happy about that. So it's just using common sense and be yourself. And of course, if you do strange things back home, and you want to do it here, then you never know.
Taking your chances,
yes,
baby. That's right.
Yes.
You know, we didn't talk about food because we're sitting here with two restaurants here.
Yes.
But do you have like a favorite coffee shop or maybe a favorite bakery or something like that you can share with us?
I like it's a place here now, but now it's closed during the summertime. It's called La Petite France. It's a small French pastry shop close to Molino de Agua.
Yes. Yes,
I like that. And now they open a new place called Littenbrød. It's a Danish style like coffee shop, and they're serving Danish pastries. And because I lived in southern Sweden, in a place called Helsingborg, and it's 20 minutes ferry over to Denmark. So I've been in Denmark many times, and I love Denmark. I think it's very nice, the pastries, everything, what they do. And also, there's if you want really good coffee, there's a place in PTL called Café Ina. And the owner
there... I-N-A?
Café Ina.
I-N-A.
Yes.
Okay.
And it's a wonder... They're making wonderful coffee, and they're really into this, like, quality coffee, and not expensive. And the owner is a very nice person. So I would recommend that if you love coffee.
Oh, we got coffee lovers, and so I'll have links to all those places in the show notes, of course. And I'll have links, of course, to Vitea and to Trio Restaurant. I'll even have maps that'll take you to the front door of both of them, and you can find that at www.puertovallartatravelshow.com. I'll have pictures of Olaf and of the food and of the beautiful restaurants and of Olaf's partner, who is Bernard
Goods, yes.
Yeah, Bernard. So how wonderful is that? Have I missed anything? Is there something that you wanted to talk about before we said goodbye today?
Probably that, you know, about, you know, the actual situation here in Puerto Vallarta. We are getting, you know, we have much less cases now with the COVID, and people, you know, it's bouncing back. Of course, we are still very careful with all the restaurants, and since if you come here, you know, traveling, coming into town from the airport and so on, everything, there's a lot of very high standards. All business owners, we really try to, you know, we check the temperature. We have, you know, all the staff who are working with us, and we clean everything. There's a lot of sanitizing going on. And hopefully, you know, this is going to be over very soon. And we really want this to be back to normal, no? But maybe then the new normal. So hopefully, you know, still is the magic of Puerto Vallarta is still here. It's still beautiful, wonderful place. The climate is so nice. You're sitting here, you know, in front of the ocean. It's a paradise. So we shouldn't forget that. I think it's very important.
Exactly. And that's why I'm here today, to tell everybody, don't be afraid. Come to Puerto Vallarta. Have a good time. Follow the protocols. And be careful in that way. But it's exactly right. It's still the magical place that it's always been.
Yes, yes.
Well, absolutely. Thank you. Tell us again how we can find you. You're on, you've got Instagram, you've got Facebook.
Yes, we have Instagram, Facebook for both restaurants. So you can check us there. If you have any questions, just let us know. We always try to answer. If you send us a message on your email, you can always an email to trio@triopv.com. That's our website for Trio. Or the other one is vitea@viteapv.com. So you can just call us. We're always here. So if you want to make we also do caterings. If you want to do something special, we do a lot of things also. So whatever you have any questions, just let us know.
Excellent. Okay, and what's the address over at Trio?
It's Guerrero, Warrior, like the, you know, the Warrior, Guerrero Street, Guerrero 264.
Guerrero 264. It's very close to the church, and of course I'll have a map for that so you guys can find it. And Olaf, I want to thank you so much for coming on the show today, for letting me introduce you and Trio and Vitea to my listeners. I truly appreciate that.
No, thank you. My pleasure, and hopefully, like I say, it's a wonderful place, and hopefully we can see each other soon, no? And it's wonderful having a talk with you.
Well, thank you very much. And come on, everybody. Come back to Vallarta. All right. Thank you, Ulf. Thank you so much for your time. I love your restaurant, and your story is great. I love your restaurants. anyway, I have a map and maps, and I have links to both Vitea and to Trio in the show notes. And of course, you'll know where to find them. You can find them at www.puertovallartatravelshow.com. All right. Make sure that you check out both of these great restaurants next time you're in town. And that should do it this week. Next week, stay tuned for more on-the-ground reports from Puerto Vallarta, Mexico, with travel tips, great restaurant excursion ideas, and more. But until then, remember that this is an interactive show where I depend on your questions and your suggestions about all things Puerto Vallarta. If you think of something that I should be talking about, please reach out to me by clicking on the Contact Us tab and sending us your message. And remember, if you are considering booking any type of tour while you're in Puerto Vallarta, well, then you must go to vallartainfo.com, that's JR's website, and reserve your tour through him right from his website. Remember, this is a value-for-value proposition, my friends. His experience and on-the-ground knowledge of everything Puerto Vallarta, in exchange for your making a purchase of a tour that you would do anyway. You're just doing it through him as a way of saying thank you. Thanks, JR, for being our guide. Costs no more than if you're going to use someone else. So do it, really. And when you do take one of those tours, email me about your experiences. Maybe come on board and share with others what you liked or didn't like about the tour. Again, contact me by clicking on the Contact Us tab and sending off a message. And don't forget, JR's got his maps, his DIY tours, his revitalized happy hour board, and more. And I have links to all those in the show notes. Hey, once again, if you like this podcast, take the time and subscribe, and tell your friends, give me a good review wherever you happen to be listening to your podcast, and that way we can get the word out to more and more people about the magic of this place, Puerto Vallarta, Mexico. Remember, I made it easy for you to do just that with each episode I create, but if you haven't been to my website, you really need to have a look there. I have links to the places that we talk about, I have interesting pictures and more right there in the blog posts and in the show notes for each episode of the show. So check them out for sure if you haven't already. All right? Well, all right. Thank you, Ulf Hendrickson. Thanks for coming on the show. Thanks for telling us all about your beautiful restaurants, about Vitea Oceanfront Bistro, and about Trio Restaurant in central Puerto Vallarta. Make sure you go. Make sure you check out the pictures. Have links to everything that we talked about and check them out in the show notes. Remember, we've got some great cocktails, they've got great views, and they've got the most delicious food. Thanks to all of you for listening all the way through this episode of the Puerto Vallarta Travel Show. This is Barry Kessler signing off with a wish for all of you to slow down, be kind, and live the Vallarta lifestyle. Nos vemos, amigos.
Samba de Puerto Vallarta.